टू वॉट पर्टिकुलर डिजीज एनी पेशेंट इज सफरिंग फ्रॉम। इफ यू केयरफुली एनालाइज द हिस्ट्री डिटेल्स ऑफ द ओटोरिया इन द हिस्ट्री इट सेल्फ 70 to 80% ऑफ द डायग्नोसिस कैन बी मेड एंड फर्दर इट कैन बी प्रूव्ड एंड सपोर्टेड बाई डूइंग क्लिनिकल एग्जामिनेशन। इट्स इम्पॉर्टेंट टू टेक द हिस्ट्री डिटेल पॉइंट्स। तो टूडे वी विल अगेन रिवाइज वॉट ऑल हिस्ट्री पॉइंट्स टू बी कंसिडर्ड वाइल इवेल्युएटिंग द पेशेंट्स विथ ओटोरिया। देन वी विल अगेन सी वॉट आर द कॉमन क्लिनिकल कंडीशंस विच प्रेजेंट्स विथ ओटोरिया एंड वॉट आर द कैरेक्टरिस्टिक फीचर्स ऑफ ईयर डिस्चार्ज इन दोज पर्टिकुलर डिजीज। तो दिस इज ऑल वी आर गोइंग टू सी इन टूडेज लेक्चर। दिस टॉपिक इज इम्पॉर्टेंट। यू कैन गेट अ फुल क्वेश्चन ऑन दिस राइट डिफरेंशियल डायग्नोसिस ऑफ ओटोरिया और इन क्लिनिकल एग्जामिनेशन ऑल्सो लाइक प्रैक्टिकल एग्जामिनेशन देयर कैन बी केस ऑफ सी एस ओ एम विच प्रेजेंट्स विद ओटोरिया। सो इन बोथ कंस्ट्रक्ट थ्योरी एज वेल एज प्रैक्टिकल दिस इज अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट एंड बेसिक टॉपिक।
We are unable to supply.
हेलो
Whenever you are exercising, our muscles are demanding more oxygen, but that much amount of oxygen you are unable to supply.
Hello.
So you all are perfect right now.
Hello. Somebody's.
This type of glycolysis will take place.
Somebody's audio is on. Hello. So it is important to know all the details regarding this basic concept of ओटोरिया। So as you correctly told, ओटोरिया is discharge from the ear. So any disease, let it be ear disease, nose disease, throat disease, or in that matter any disease from other field also, abdominal cavity, brain, all these diseases can be divided into five basic categories. Either the disease can be congenital, it can be traumatic, it can be infective, it can be neoplastic, and the one which doesn't fit into above these groups, we call it as a miscellaneous. So by and large, if we see, all the diseases can be categorized into any one of these groups. So while evaluating the patients also, our aim has to be classify these patients into one of these groups. So I am repeat once again, these groups are congenital, traumatic, inflammatory, neoplastic or miscellaneous. So that is our aim of ultimate history taking and clinical examination, to diagnose the disease and categorize into one of these groups. So similarly, considering ओटोरिया also, that the diseases can be divided into, the diseases which cause ओटोरिया, they can be divided into congenital, traumatic, inflammatory, neoplastic or miscellaneous. So hearing aid use, long term hearing aid use, or people who use earplugs, swimmers or people who are working in a noisy industries, they have a habit of using earplugs. These things also can create ओटोरिया, inflammation of the external canal and ओटोरिया. So this can be categorized under the group of miscellaneous diseases. You will be wondering how peritonitis is responsible for ओटोरिया. We know the anterior wall of external canal has a very thin bone, very thin parchment like bone which separates the parotid gland from the external auditory canal. So if there is a peritonitis with pus formation in the parotid gland, it can easily pierce the thin parchment like bone of anterior wall of external canal and burst out into the external canal, and the pus will start draining out through the external canal. We will think that this is some disease of the ear which is creating discharge, but it's not the ear discharge, it's in fact a Parotid abscess, which has burst into the external canal and the pus is draining out. So we have to keep that also in mind, that diseases of the surrounding organs or structures can also lead to the ear discharge or otorrhea. So coming to the different diseases of the excretory canal which leads to the ear discharge, first and foremost common is otitis externa, otomycosis. Mycosis is fungal infection, fungal infestation of the excretory canal, furunculosis, keratosis obturans, malignant or necrotizing otitis externa, acute seborrheic or eczematous dermatitis, parotid abscess, as I just now told you, externotic canal cholecystoma, and some tumors, malignant or benign tumors of the externotic canal. These all are responsible for creating discharge which is coming from the external auditory canal. Now, one most important basic dictum we all have to remember, that if the discharge is mucoid, that means if there is a mucus component in the discharge, so can anyone tell me where the mucus glands are situated in the ear? This we have discussed during the anatomy of ear. Hello? Hello.
Yes, sir, you're audible.
Yeah, so where the mucus yes, glands are situated in the ear? What is the lining of external auditory canal? Up to the tympanic membrane. So external auditory canal up to the tympanic membrane has a squamous epithelium. It's a skin.
Yes, sir.
Right. And behind the tympanic membrane, in the middle ear cleft and middle ear cavity proper, it's a columnar or cuboidal type of epithelium. And this middle ear cleft has the mucus and serous secreting glands. So that indirectly means what? When the patient complains of mucoid or mucopurulent type of ear discharge, it is when there is a mucus component in the discharge. So where from the discharge is coming, which part of the ear the discharge is coming?
Middle ear or internal
ear.
Good, good. So this is a basic important thing we have to remember. Mucoid or mucopurulent discharge, that means there is an involvement of middle ear cleft or middle ear cavity, right? So if it is a frank purulent serous or serous sanguineous type of discharge, it may come from middle ear or may come from external ear. But when there is a mucoid component in the discharge, it cannot be purely from external auditory canal. It must be from the middle ear. So that is the basic most important dictum we have to remember, right? So now we know the lining of the excretory canal is squamous epithelium, it's a skin. The outer cartilaginous portion of the excretory canal has small hairs. Those hairs we call, right, those very tiny hairs are there. Few people have extra amount of hairs with extra length in the excretory canal. What function these hairs perform is the protection of the inner part of the excretory canal. So catching the dust particles, large coarse foreign bodies in the hair itself, and they don't allow these particles to go inside. Right? So this is the advantage of hairy part of the external auditory canal. Now there are, and this excretory canal, it's a self-cleansing part. That means the squamous, again we have discussed squamous epithelium, wherever we have got a skin or squamous epithelium all over our body. The typical feature of this squamous epithelium is that the superficial cells are dead, and these cells, they keep spreading into the external environment, and the new cells keep growing from the basement membrane. So that is the peculiarity of squamous epithelium. Now the same squamous epithelium is there up to the tympanic membrane lining the external auditory canal. So the same property of the squamous epithelium is present in the external auditory canal also. The superficial cells keep getting shredded into the external auditory canal. Then what happens to these dead cells? Do they get accumulated there only in the external auditory canal? No. Along with the secretions of the seruminous glands, they take part in formation of a wax, and there is a always continuous outward movement of these dead epithelial cells to the towards the pinna. And these dead cells, along with some waxy material, is shredded into the environment. When we chew, when we talk, along with the movement of temporomandibular joint, there is some movement of pinna near the external auditory canal also occurs, and these all dead material is shredded into the environment. So per se, the external auditory canal is a self-cleansing part of our human body, right? But in some cases, there is a tendency for this accumulation of this wax into the external auditory canal. Accumulation of wax, accumulation of debris. And this natural cleaning process is hampered. Now, what are the different things or these predisposing factors which encourage this collection of the dead cells or waxy material in the external canal? The first and foremost, as I told, is the excessive hairs in the external auditory canal. People who are having excessive coarse hairs in the external auditory canal, in those cases, is likely that this waxy material, these dead epithelial cells, may get collected for a long period of time. The second is very narrow external auditory canal. In some patients, congenitally, the external auditory canal opening is very narrow. In those patients also, there are likely chances that this wax may get collected. The third thing is tortuous external auditory canal. It is S-shaped. Normally also, not straight, it is S-shaped. But in people in whom the canal is more tortuous, in those cases also, there are chances that wax may get collected. Apart from that, the other predisposing factors are osteomas and exostosis. We have seen these diseases while we were discussing about diseases of external ear. Osteoma is a single pedunculated bony overgrowth from the lateral part of external auditory canal. And exostosis is multiple bony outgrowths, but they are sessile and they are little medial side of the external auditory canal, that is nearer to the tympanic membrane. So these osteomas and exostosis, what they do, they occlude the part of external auditory canal and they hamper this natural cleaning process of the external auditory canal. So this is how they will encourage the accumulation of this dead material, debris, into the external auditory canal and invite secondary infection, and it will start discharging. So this is how exostosis and osteomas are responsible for creating otitis externa. Canal dehiscence into the mastoid. Sometimes congenitally there is a dehiscence from the mastoid into the external auditory canal. Infection, virulent discharge from the mastoid can directly drain to the external auditory canal, and from there it can keep draining into the exterior. So canal dehiscence connecting the mastoid and external auditory canal can be responsible for otorrhea. Otitis media with perforation, that we are going to see in bit detail. Safe type, unsafe type, or acute otitis media, all can create different type of discharge. And lastly, allergy to eardrops. So you know, lot many different combinations of eardrops are available, which are prescribed for different types of ear diseases. It can be simple antibiotic containing eardrops, plain antibiotic like ciprofloxacin, or antibiotic and steroid containing eardrops like Ciprox D, that is ciprofloxacin, dexamethasone. Some are combination of antibiotic, antifungal, steroid. Some are plain antifungal eardrops like clotrimazole eardrops. Clotrimazole is an antifungal. So sometimes people are allergic to one of the component of this eardrops. Many people are allergic to this antifungal eardrops. And if we advise these antifungal eardrops, they next or third day, these patients, they come with a swelled pinna, swelled extensory canal. There is reddening, itching, and in fact, the condition will worsen. They come for the, initially they come for the pain in ear or blocking sensation in the ear, deep in the extensory canal. Pinna is normal. If we do clinical examination, we see fungal debris. We clean that fungal debris under microscope and we prescribe them antifungal eardrops to prevent the further growth of fungus. Initially, the patient is fine. Ear blocking sensation is gone as we have cleaned the extensory canal. And we expect the patient to be comfortable. But when they come for follow-up, we are shocked. Patient is also worried. So there was nothing in the pinna, pinna was normal, there was no swelling in the external part of the ear. But see what has happened. So we have to keep in mind, probably it is allergy to eardrops. So we have to immediately stop those eardrops and give local ointment along with short course of oral steroid and antihistamine, so that inflammation will subside. Of course, along with the oral antibiotic cover. So this is how this allergy can present in the form of purulent or serosanguinous discharge. The discharge is usually serosanguinous. So coming to the causes or diseases in the tympanic membrane, which presents with the ear discharge. So sometimes because of repeated infections or collected debris in the extraordinary canal, there is a reactive inflammation in the tympanic membrane also, and that leads to the formation of granulation tissue over the tympanic membrane, and this granulation tissue keeps on creating a discharge which starts coming out through the extraordinary canal. So whenever there is a granulation tissue, the discharge is serosanguinous, a bit of blood stinge into it. So one of the differential diagnosis for blood stained ear discharge, granulation tissue. Granular meningitis or bullous meningitis, those are again viral infections present in the form of granulation and air filled or fluid filled bully over the tympanic membrane. And they also present with serous or serosanguinous discharge. Tympanic membrane perforation, either it can be traumatic or maybe because of acute suppurative otitis media or chronic suppurative otitis media. In both these conditions, patient will present with discharge along with other complaints. Like in acute otitis media, there will be severe earache, discharge and diminished hearing. In chronic suppurative otitis media, history will be long standing, but there won't be earache per se. The patient will present with ear discharge and deafness. Retraction pockets, we know the tympanic membrane makes an angle of 45 degree to the floor. But otherwise it is stout and clean. In cases with long standing negative middle ear pressure, maybe because of eustachian tube obstruction or because of long-standing compromised ventilation of middle ear cleft, The posterior superior part of the tympanic membrane starts getting retracted towards the mastoid. And that leads to the formation of retraction pocket. So we know outer layer of tympanic membrane also has a squamous epithelial covering. Squamous epithelial cells, they will get spread into the excretory canal. And along with the debris in the excretory canal, it will get cleaned into the exterior. But when the pocket goes on increasing and the opening of the pocket becomes narrower and narrower, the dead epithelial cells will not get shred into the excretory canal. They will get collected there only in the excretory canal, layer by layer. It is a keratin debris. And whenever there is a collection, it may invite a secondary infection. And that leads to the formation of cholesteatoma. So it's a skin, squamous epithelium, arranged like a onion pills, and with the central keratin debris. So this also presents with the discharge. So characteristics of discharge in safe and unsafe disease we know, but still we will discuss in further few slides what are the, how the discharge quality, frequency, quantity, how it helps in differentiating safe and unsafe type of ear disease. So diseases in the middle ear, acute or chronic suppurative otitis media, mastoiditis, cholesteatoma, and some granulomatous diseases like tuberculosis. Most important is tuberculosis. That also presents with ear discharge. And neoplasms, benign and malignant neoplasms of the middle ear and mastoid. So as I told one dictum, that whenever there is a mucoid component in the discharge, we have to take it as it is coming from the disease of the middle ear. Similarly, one more dictum is there. Bloodstained purulent ear discharge. The discharge which is bloodstained and purulent. Nasal or oral. In an elderly patient, elderly aged patients, has to be considered coming from the malignant disease of that organ unless otherwise proved. Right? So this is a worrisome symptom. Purulent, blood-stained, foul-smelling ear discharge. Right? One more component is a foul-smelling ear discharge. So even if the purulent, foul-smelling, blood-stained ear discharge is coming from the ear or nose in an elderly patient, first thing we have to keep in mind as a differential diagnosis is malignancy of that organ. And we have to do the clinical examination accordingly. If we find proliferative growth or ulcerative growth or a granulation tissue, we have to take a biopsy in all these cases to rule out malignancy as well as granulomatous disease. थोड़ा वेळ नाही बघे की माझं लेक्चर चालू आहे एक अर्ध्या तासाने. And as I told, there are some miscellaneous conditions like CSF otoria. So we know the roof of the middle ear as well as the mastoid is formed by a thin bone. The thin bone which separates the mastoid and middle ear from the temporal lobe. That we call as a tegment tympani and tegment antri. So, in case of accidental injuries which create fracture in the temporal bone, or during surgical procedures on the mastoid, like mastoidectomies, when we are drilling the mastoid to exteriorize and remove the cholestatoma flex. Sometimes the disease is so extensive that there can be a trauma to these bony plates, tegmenti and tegmen antri, during the process of drilling. And that leads to the breach in the bony partition between the mastoid and the temporal lobe. And the dura also, it gets damaged. The CSF starts leaking into the mastoid cavity. So that can lead to the CSF otorrhea. But in otherwise, the patients who met rotary accidents with a sort of head injury, always we have to keep in the mind of CSF otorrhea. So during clinical examination for evaluation of head injury, we also have to examine the ear also, external canal. So in those cases, what we'll get? A clear watery discharge coming out through the external auditory canal. So we have to keep in mind the differential diagnosis of injury to the tegmen plate or fracture in the temporal bone. And under neoplastic conditions, there can be glomus tumor, you see, one of the benign tumors, and or it can be malignant tumor in the external canal or middle ear. So what points we have to consider while taking the history related to the ear discharge or otorrhea? Let us ask for the onset. If the onset is sudden, it can be acute otitis media. If it is insidious and long standing, probably we are dealing with a case of chronic otitis media. Inflammatory conditions of the external canal also, like otitis externa, furunculosis, they also present with acute onset of ear discharge. Duration is important. If it is within 3 weeks, probably we are dealing with some acute condition. If it is from 3 weeks to 3 months, it is a subacute condition. And if it is more than 3 months, probably we are dealing with chronic ear disease. Progression, of course. Some diseases, they initially start with serous discharge. It turns out to be later on blood-stained, mucopurulent, and then it becomes mucoid for long period of time. So this is the course of the discharge pattern in a particular patient. So what hint we get from this one particular pattern? So initially it was mucopurulent and blood-stained. Means probably it was acute otitis media where the tympanic membrane got perforated, the superficial blood vessel got torn, and because of that initially it was blood stained and mucopurulent. Once this initial acute stage is over, later on the perforation remains as it is, doesn't heal, and the discharge becomes purely mucoid or mucopurulent. So now probably the patient has gone into the chronic suppurative otitis media, stage of chronic CSM. So this is how understanding the progression helps us in going towards the diagnosis. Onset, duration and progress. The second part, important part to know, is whether it is continuous or intermittent. Continuous means what? The patient will tell that, for example, discharge started 2 or 3 years back and it is there throughout, every day almost since it started. It has never stopped completely. Even I went to the local doctors, they gave some medications in the form of tablets and air discharge, but it didn't disappear. It's there only. This is sort of continuous discharge. The other variety is intermittent. In this variety, what history the patient will give is that I had a cold, throat pain, fever for 2-3 days. After that, suddenly I had a blocking in the ear, followed by earache, and the discharge started. I went to the local doctor, I took a treatment in the form of medicines and eardrops, and the discharge stopped. But again, after 4-5 months or 1 year or 1 month, again I got cold or water entered into the external canal, and again it started draining. So this kind of episodes are getting repeated since last 2-3 years or 1 year. This is the intermittent types of discharge. Intermittent means what? In between the two episodes, there is a phase where the patient doesn't have any kind of ear discharge and it is dry. This is an intermittent type of discharge. So as we all know, this continuous type of discharge is present in chronic otitis media of unsafe type, which presents with either retraction pocket or cholestatoma. Whereas intermittent type of discharge is typically a presentation of chronic suppurative otitis media of safe type or tuber tympanic type, which presents with central perforation. Right? So this is how it helps to knowing whether it is continuous or intermittent in coming to the differential diagnosis of otorrhea. The other important part which what we have to ask is profuse, moderate or scanty. So moderate is a bit a confusing term, but profuse and scanty we can definitely ask. Profuse means what? The patient will tell that the ear is pouring, mucopurulent or purulent type of discharge is pouring out from the ear, it's not the canal. I keep a cotton, but in 2-3 hours, I have to change it because it is wet. Again, I keep the another fresh cotton, again it gets soaked. And I have to, like this, I have to change 5-6 times cotton plug. So this is typical a profuse kind of discharge. The other variety is scanty. That means what the patient will tell, typically these patients have a habit of changing the cotton plug only during the bath, at the time of bath. They'll tell every day morning before having bath, I change the cotton. It is just slightly soaked. And I keep that cotton, I change it next day only. So this is a scanty type of discharge. So again, what is the significance? Profuse discharge is characteristic feature of CSOM of safe or tuber tympanic type. Whereas scanty discharge, it is indicative of unsafe type of CSOM. Similarly, we have to ask whether discharge is associated with smell. A foul smelling ear discharge again indicates an unsafe type of CSOM or cholestatoma. And the one which is not associated with any kind of smell probably indicate a safe type of CSOM or other disease. And quality or color, mucoid, mucopurulent, blood stain, serous, serosanguinous, these also have a typical presentation in different diseases. Diseases of the external ear like eczematous otitis externa, seborrheic otitis externa, we get a serosanguinous discharge. In case of furunculosis or abscess in the external canal, when it bursts out, we get a frank purulent discharge. The mucoid discharge, ASOM in a later stages or CSOM. Mucopurulent or purulent, CSOM of unsafe type. Blood stain, maybe a traumatic perforation, accidental injuries to the external canal or middle ear, or tumors, benign and malignant tumors of the external and middle ear. In those cases, we get blood stain type of discharge. In plain watery discharge, of course, it is indicative of CSF otorrhea. So this is how, knowing all these details, helps us in coming to the differential diagnosis of CSU. Right? So very important. Almost all cases present with autorhea, and we have to elaborate the history under all these headings. Right? Onset duration and progress, continuous or intermittent, profuse or scanty, whether associated any foul smell or not, and what is the quality, mucoid, mucopurulent, serous, serous sanguinous, purulent or watery. One more thing we have to ask is whether the discharge is associated with attacks of upper respiratory tract infection. As we know, in unsafe type of CSOM presenting with the cholestatoma, there won't be relation between the upper respiratory infection and discharge. But in case of safe type of CSOM, these patients typically they will tell that I get a cold, sore throat, running nose, and then only the ear discharge starts. So that means it is associated with URK. So the episodic discharge, intermittent type of discharge, which is associated with URTI, is indicative of safe type of CSOM. Whereas the continuous type of discharge, which doesn't have any relation with the episode of URTI, we indicate unsafe type of CSOM. So what examination we have to do? Any patient presenting with ear discharge, the first and foremost thing what we have to do is ear microscopy and suction clean. So patient came, we did examination of the external canal by pulling pinna upwards, outwards and laterally with the help of head mirror, and we saw the purulent or mucopurulent discharge in the external canal. As we know, there are different reasons for it. It can be ASOM, it can be CSOM of safe type, it can be CSOM of unsafe type. Further examination of the tympanic membrane can help us in coming to the one particular diagnosis, either ASOM or CSOM. Is it ASOM or CSOM? So for that matter, we have to do the examination of tympanic membrane. And for doing examination of the tympanic membrane, we have to clean the ear first, either suction cleaning or a mopping of the external canal with the help of cotton wisp, that is dry mopping. So unless we clean the discharge and do the examination, we cannot come to the diagnosis. Then we have to see for edema or inflammation or glandulation polyp growth in the external canal, and tympanic membrane for presence of perforation, granulations. There can be myringotomy tube, that is grommet, which is inserted by previous people. That also can be there.